Hey everyone, in this video, I want to do a problem about graph theory that is a solution to a bioinformatics problem. So, kind of applying graph theory to bioinformatics or statistical genetics. And this is the problem. Before I go into specifically solving this problem, I'm going to give some background first. The problem comes from bioinformatics, and specifically, it's a problem about DNA sequencing. When you have any organism's DNA, it's going to be probably billions of pairs of nucleotides, and nucleotides can be one of four letters, so they can be A, G, T, C, and this can be any value for the billions of nucleotides that make up a DNA sequence. When doing DNA sequencing, the idea is that you are finding out at each position of the genome what is the nucleotide value at a specific position. So if you think of a DNA sequence sort of like a string, it would be trying to figure out what letter is in each position of an entire string, where a string is the DNA sequence. So this is known as DNA sequencing. Because the DNA strand is so long for many organisms, so for example, for a human, it would be billions of characters long, what is done in bioinformatics is that a DNA string is broken up into fragments. So from the entire DNA strand, there are fragments that are created of DNA, and each fragment is a piece of the entire DNA sequence, and these small pieces can be sequenced accurately. The problem then for bioinformaticians becomes how do people take these fragments of which the sequences are known and arrange them again in the correct order so that the first fragment corresponds to the first position, the second fragment in the second position, and so on and so forth to be able to recreate an entire DNA sequence. This problem is known as DNA fragment assembly, and it has one possible solution using graph theory. So that is an example problem that we're going to do in this video. So I'm going to erase this. Using this problem as a simplified version of what DNA sequencing would be like, it says, given a set S of k-mers, find a DNA sequence such that the spectrum S of 3 is equal to capital S. So when you have these DNA fragments, they're going to be of a certain length, which is the number of nucleotides on each fragment. And these fragments can also be called k-mers, where k is usually the number of nucleotides per DNA fragment. In this particular example, we're given a set of fragments that are three nucleotides or three letters long. So this could also be known as a 3-mer or k-mers of size 3. And the problem is saying that we are given the sets of DNA fragments that are three characters long or three nucleotides long, and we have to recreate capital S, which would be the DNA sequence. And you could think of this basically as a string problem where you're given fragments of substrings and we want to recreate the superstring, which is the original sequence. So a spectrum is just defined as the set of all DNA fragments, and we're going to have to perform DNA fragment assembly. And so that's the problem, and the solution is going to be performed using graph theory as one possible way of solving this problem. And the solution I'm going to go over in this video is called finding the Eulerian path through a de Bruijn graph. And this solution is performed as follows. So for each DNA fragment, each three-character substring that we have, we're going to create a graph of overlapping sequences. And the overlap is going to be found by taking k minus 1. So in this case, each fragment is three letters long. So each vertex is going to be k minus 1, which would be two characters long. For ACT, I'm going to have a vertex in the graph called AC. Similar for ATG, the next vertex would be AT, and so on for each fragment. So I finished creating all my k minus 1 vertices from the fragments that we're given, and the way we're going to get these sequences of the full length, which is of length 3 for each fragment, is we're going to create these fragments from the edges of the graph. So that's how the de Bruijn graphs are constructed. Their edges are the overlapping sequences. So to start with the fragment ACT, we know we have the vertex AC, and we want to find a second vertex that is going to have the overlap C, and the next character has to be T. From this graph, the only vertex that AC can go to is going to be CT, because ACT is going to be created from the edge from the overlap of C. So we get ACT from this edge. And we're going to just continue this process for each fragment in the set of k-mers that we have. So from CT, we have another fragment that is CTG, and we need a vertex that's going to overlap with the value T. So that would be this vertex here. Putting an edge from CT and TG is going to give us the edge CTG, which is another fragment. From TG, we can go to TGA, which is here. From GA, we can go to the next fragment, GAT. So we're going to go from GA to AT. From AT, I'm going to go to TG. From TG, I'm going to go to GC. GC goes to CA. And finally, CA goes to AT. Now that we have constructed the de Bruijn graph of overlapping sequences, the way we're going to find the original DNA sequence is by finding the Eulerian path through the diagram. And that is just the path where you're going to pass through each edge one time. So that is the definition of an Eulerian path. So using this diagram and the directed edges, the original DNA sequence S is going to be starting at AC, because there are no edges that point to AC, so that's going to be our starting node. The first value is going to be AC, then C is an overlap here, so the first letter after AC is going to be T. So we have ACT, I'm going to mark this edge as 1. Then CT goes to TG, so it's going to be ACTG. This is edge 2. From TG, I'm going to go to GC. So I'm going to mark this as 3. GC goes to A, mark this as 4. CA goes to AT, then back to TG, then GA, and finally GA goes to AT. From this original set of fragments that are 3 characters long, we were able to reconstruct a superstring, which is a viable option for the solution of the original DNA sequence. And this was performed using the Eulerian path through the de Bruijn graph. I will say that in this particular example, which is a bit of a simplification of how it would be done in real life, because in real life the k-mers would be a little bit longer, there is more than one solution possible for this particular example. In some cases for the de Bruijn graphs, there's more than one possible Eulerian path. So in this case, this is one solution for how the DNA sequence could be. There's also another Eulerian path, which happens here when you go out of TG. In this example, I went from TG to GC, but I could have also equally gone from TG to GA, and that would have been a second Eulerian path through the graph. If you go that way, then your solution for the original DNA string would have been ACT, GAT, GCAT. And this is another equally possible solution. And so sometimes there's more than one solution possible using this method, but this is usually avoided by also having additional information about the organism and having longer strands where it's less likely to have overlap between the vertices because you have more nucleotides in the substrings. But this is all I wanted to go over in this video. And so I will end the video now, and thank you guys for watching.